Wanted to do a touch on a couple of things before I start the Sunday lesson. One is that next week we're finally going to start this the long form meditation at 9:30. So from 9:30 to 9:45, over in the Fillmore room, we'll have people facilitating a long meditation, you know, with at least 10 minutes of silence. You know, we did some surveys here back a month or two ago, and we found there was kind of a split in the congregation as to whether you wanted a shorter silence in the meditation or the longest. So we feel this will be a way to accommodate everybody. So we'll have the longer one at 9:30, and then within the meditation in the service, we'll just have a shorter silence. Second thing I wanted to mention is that, you know, each week I have a set of takeaways for you, usually printed out. It unfortunately was left behind on my printer. I can't imagine who would walk away from his printer without forgetting to bring that. So I'll post it on our Unity of Tampa website the Facebook page here a little bit later. But these should be easy enough to remember if you just want to scribble them down. So that's the deal for today. So good morning. Carla and I in the 1990s, you know, were traveling and doing prosperity seminars, Unity's prosperity principles all over the place. We met a lot of wonderful ministers, and we met this one guy. His name is Chad O'Shea, passed away a few years ago. Kind of a bear of a guy, full beard, grew up in Brooklyn, and he became somewhat infamous in Unity because he grew up in Brooklyn, so he had a lot of four-letter adjectives in his speech. And he got the congregation in Asheville, North Carolina. And so he became kind of well known as the guy who would let those four-letter adjectives fly in his Sunday lesson. But the people there in Asheville just loved him for who he was and all of that. But Chad liked to share that when he was a young man in Brooklyn, the Billy Graham Crusades came through town. You know, so Billy would usually get like a big stadium, and you know, he'd give a barn burner of a speech, and then he'd call everybody forward, the altar call, you know, and, you know, not take Jesus Christ as your Savior. And so, you know, so Chad went down and was enthusiastic and felt great that night, so he decided to come back the next night. Problem was, Billy Graham was just preaching the same thing, and then they're telling everybody to come down, and he finds one of the staff, and says, "What's going on? I mean, we did this yesterday, you know. What's next?" And he goes, "Oh, you don't have to worry about what's next. You've been born again." And Chad is like, no, that can't be just a one-time born again. There just seems to be a lot more to it in his intuition. So sure enough, he continued his spiritual search and eventually became a Unity minister. But this concept of being born again, of course, you know, is very big among evangelical Christians. So I wanted to take a look at it because, you know, Unity, of course, has a whole different approach to the Bible. We recognize that it's kind of the story of the growing consciousness of a human being from the very early words of Genesis and Adam and Eve, where you have finally your belief and your feelings awakening to spirit for the first time, all the way to the book of Revelations, where finally, after people have embraced this new form of spirituality that Jesus Christ was teaching, you know, you kind of have that final inner battle where you're willing to fully accept, you know, that we are spiritual beings having a human experience. So in the Gospel of John, third chapter, starting with the first verse, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a high priest of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these things, these miracles that you do, unless God is with him." Jesus looked at him and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born anew, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter into his mother's womb a second time and be born?" Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus, here again, every character in these Bible narrative stories represents some aspect of ourselves. So here's Nicodemus, a high priest. Nicodemus represents that spiritual belief that we had before we took it to a new level. Sometimes, you know, people are following the letter of the law, not the spirit of the law, you know, as it says elsewhere in the Bible. So Nicodemus represents that kind of conventional wisdom or fundamentalist approach of just doing something by rote. And as you can see, as Nicodemus first comes in, he's kind of buttering up Jesus. But Jesus kind of looks to his soul and sees what he really wants. And so he says, you know, you need to be born anew or born again. And born again or born, the word that's used there means anew, it means again, it also means from above. You know, the word that was translated in this out of the Greek. And that's, you know, that's happened to so many of us. We'll be following a spiritual belief system, and then suddenly, whoa, wait a minute. This is different than what I've experienced before, but it's better. And so when Jesus says, you know, born of the Spirit, water, of course, is physical world. Spirit is spiritual world. And to be born again means basically having that new awareness, that new consciousness. So in some people's life, it can happen once, but in the vast majority of our lives, it happens more than once. It can happen again and again and again as we have that new realization, as we start to let go of old assumptions that we've had in our life. I had one just this earlier this week. I had this memory of when I was in high school, and you know, there was this girl who really liked me and, you know, wanted to date, but I had unworthiness issues and stuff back then, so I kind of rejected her, you know. And I was thinking back, oh wow, gee, I wish I could, you know, see Gloria and apologize for that. But then it occurred to me, wait a minute, this was in high school. I was a stupid high school kid, and yet I'm still kind of carrying around that guilt, you know, that I have to, and then all these other times where I treated somebody unpleasantly started to rush back, and I'm like, oh yeah, you know, that there's that inner perfectionist in my, or as I call it, my inner recovering perfectionist, you know, who wants to just make good to everybody. And it was just kind of that sense of like, oh wow, I'm still, after all these years, kind of carrying that around. Can I let go of that guilt? You know, I'm sure Gloria is fine wherever she is, and some of these other people that, you know, that I felt like I had done wrong. And of course, it was a realization of just that I didn't know any better at the time. I just did the best with what I had. So we can be born again and again and again and again. You know, the old second chance. Well, with spirit, it is not just a second chance. We can have a third chance, a fourth chance, a fifth chance, as we learn how to do it better, as we learn who we truly are, and also who we truly are not. One of Unity's best-selling books is Discover the Power Within You, you know, by Reverend Eric Butterworth. Oprah Winfrey, when she really started doing her book club, came up with a list of the 10 books that changed her life. And one of them was Discover the Power Within You by Eric Butterworth. And of course, we did a discussion group on Discover the Power Within You last year. In the book, on page 6, Eric Butterworth says, "We don't know when it happened, or even what happened. We only know that sometime between Jesus' birth and his miracle-working ministry at 30 years of age, he achieved a unique relationship with God and became a channel for the expression of powers no one had ever dreamed of." Butterworth called this the great discovery, and it's a discovery that can happen to any of us. So that's where this, you know, born-again thing kind of comes in. There was a moment where Jesus knew that he wasn't just a human being, that he was divine. He had a potential for wholeness that he never, well, we don't know for sure, but, you know, he didn't seem to realize before. And I had that same, you know, experience, you know, at age 30, finally just awakening to the fact that, wow, okay, I can let go of all of that unworthiness. I can let go of those high school experiences like I was describing before, and come into, as a lot of people call it, step into my power, you know, have that realization where I'm empowered to go forward and make a difference in the world for the better. So, in mainstream Christianity, they like to talk about the divinity of Jesus Christ, but I believe, you know, he was a way shower for us that, hey, we all have that capability. Rather than looking at Jesus' divinity, let's look at what Jesus taught. Rather than trying to find some meaning to his death, because, you know, they couldn't understand how the Messiah, who was supposed to save them, could be, you know, executed by the Roman Empire. So they're trying to find out some meaning to his death. Well, wait a minute, what about his life? You know, what about what he taught and who he was? And I believe that Jesus taught that, yes, we don't need to be more spiritual. We're already spiritual beings having a human experience, and that God energy lives in each of us. So when did you know? When did you cross that threshold? When do you have that awakening of like, wow, yeah, yeah. Now I realize we've got some people who have maybe been here for 20 minutes and others for well over 20 years, but there is that divinity in all of us. And yet, at least for a portion of my life, I found that I was asleep to that potential. And when I awakened, it was kind of like, ah, I could almost hear some anthropomorphic God on the other side say, oh, good, you're awake. Now we can move forward. One of the mind blowers, though, is if there is a divinity within each of us, then there's divinity within the people that we like and then the people we don't like. Each person is expressing something to give us an opportunity to look at what we want to identify with, what do we want to embrace as principles in this world, or is this an expression that I want to reject, say, no, that's not me. So when we find a book like, say, Discover the Power Within You, the first reaction might be, whoa, but then the second reaction is, wow, and okay. So this great discovery. Can we decide to live our life if we are expressing God's will in this world? Can we become a channel for the expression of powers no one had ever dreamed of, as Eric Butterworth put it? When Moses asked God what his name was when he was facing the burning bush, God said, I am that I am. So when we use the words I am, we're declaring who we believe we are. And if we are identifying with the divine rather than with, say, unworthiness, we can establish, like I say, a new level of expression. In Alan Cohen is a man who's written a number of books, you know, related to unity, and he wrote a book called The Deep Breath of Life. And in it, he describes a woman who had this common unworthiness that so many of us have. And she had this new realization of like, wow, you know, I should feel empowered. And she was sitting in an airport, you know, waiting room near the gate, and she noticed this very attractive man. And she she recognized how many times in her life, you know, she'd see someone like that but wouldn't approach them. So today's like, I'm going to approach him. So she went and talked to the gentleman and expressed, you know, how she found him very attractive. And the guy was very cordial. This wasn't one of those magical stories, though. He was married. But they had a nice conversation. But afterwards, she kind of said, yes, you know, I had the courage to do that, you know, for the first time in my life. And so when the right guy is there, you know, I'll have the courage to do it again. And she also recognized she was open to attracting, you know, that right and perfect companion. Well, so we need to just be willing to let go of these old stories, these assumptions that we've come up with. You know, like I said last week, well, there's no rule book of life, so we come up with our own rules. So we figure out which of these assumptions and old rules really don't serve us anymore, and we move on. Now, Carla and I, you know, went to Unity's seminary, and it's interesting because in Unity's seminary, it seems like most of the students are like in their 40s and 50s. It's one of those phenomenons where it seems like once a person has lived their life for a little while, you know, then they're willing to be able to speak from that experience. But you know, we do have. But in our class, we did have two younger women. They were both 31. One of them was Robin Ryder, who's now the Unity minister in Venice, Florida. And Robin talked about one of these experiences of something she learned as a child that she had to finally let go of. When she was 4 years old, she loved the Muppets and in the Muppet movie, and so she got a cassette. And of course, one of the songs was the Rainbow Connection, you know, with Kermit singing. Why are there so many songs about rainbows and what's on the other side? You know, so she. So she, you know, she learned all of these songs, and especially this first one. And the family was in the car, so, you know, mom, dad, her older brother, and her, and she announced that she was going to sing for everybody. So she started out, you know, singing the Rainbow Connection, and her brother, who was just a couple years older, and she said, "Oh," and he started howling like a dog. He said, "Oh, that's awful. That is absolutely awful." And Robin was just crushed. She said, "Oh." So she realized, or at least she made the assumption, that she didn't sing very well. And so as the years went by, and, you know, people would invite her to sing or get in the choir, "Oh, no, 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 I'm awful and awful." So Robin went off to college, University of Florida. Her mom, though, at the same time, got to that point where she decided she wanted to be a Unity minister. So her mom, Patricia Ryder, went to Unity's seminary and graduated and took one of the Unity congregations in Nashville. And so after Robin graduated, she went to Nashville and, you know, got a job there so that she could help, you know, in mom's church. And she, and like so many people, you know, we usually, you know, have the sing-alongs, you know, and so the woman who is the choir director happened to be standing near Robin at one point and, you know, said, "Gee, Robin, I'd really like you to join the choir." And then, you know, she did her usual spiel, "Oh, no, I sing awful." And the woman said, "No, Robin, I stood next to you when you're singing. You sing very well." And she kind of was persistent with Robin, so Robin joined the choir and decided, "Well, I'll stand next to somebody who knows how to sing well. maybe it'll keep in tune and all that." And then after she had done that for a while, the choir director came to her and said, "Robin, I'm scheduling solos. Which Sunday would you like to take?" And I can't sing solo. She goes, "Yes, you can." She goes, "Well, I'll think about it." And of course, here again, the choir director had to be persistent with her to sing a solo. And so she finally did sing a solo and got some great feedback. And she said, "Wow, I realized, thinking back to those days," you know, here she was four, her older brother was whatever, six or seven. She goes, "What I realized was that it wasn't a matter of me not singing very well. It was a matter of that every girl who's got an older brother realizes is that their older brother at times can be a doofus." And so she started to really just enjoy singing. And I know in ministerial school, we would, you know, each week one of the classmates would take, you know, a Sunday service to do, and we'd sign up our classmates to do various things. So Robin often would, you know, sing a solo in one of our mock services. But, you know, wow, what a decision, you know. And so what in your life, you know, happened maybe in your childhood that, you know, set the tone for the rest of your life in a particular area of your life? From the great discovery to the great decision, can you be who you need to be? Can you know in your heart that there is no separation between you and the God presence? Can you know that one of the reasons you're put here is to use your gifts, passions, and talents to make this world a better place? Can you realize that your gifts, passions, and talents are no better or no worse than everybody else's? You just do your part. What do you do really well? What area of your life has been impinged? Is it health, your occupation, your relationships, your money, your spiritual growth? Make a decision to take, you know, that first step in being willing to express who you really are. Act as if you are a spiritual being having a human experience. Now, I know on the back page of our bulletin on Unity of Tampa is something that goes unnoticed with a lot of people, but it's the mission and vision statement of Unity of Tampa. And this was done years ago when a group of people got together and talked about it. Now, your vision statement is you see the world the way you want it to be, and even if you have no clue as to how it happens, you set your vision statement. And our vision statement is, centered in love, we celebrate an enlightened world of peace, harmony, and abundance for all. And our mission statement, the mission statement is basically, what do you see your role here on earth as being? So for us as a community, it was established that we are a thriving spiritual community that embraces diversity and inspires personal transformation by sharing and living the unity principles. And then we came up with five core values. And those are the things that we hold dearest in our lives. One is spiritual, and then loving, inclusive, peaceful, and progressive. So, can we start to, as a community, truly express that on a regular basis? Can we let go of the limitations that we've placed on ourselves? Now, I've been talking about born again. There's a similar concept in mainline Christianity of the second coming of Jesus. And, of course, you know, when we read a lot of the things that were said there in the Gospels and some of these biblical books, they were expecting the end of the world within a generation, but it didn't happen. And that's why it's fascinating how each time we come to a major turning point, like with a lot of us, we experienced the turning point of the year 2000, you know, and there were some that were feeling like it was going to, you know, maybe that was the end of the world, because we find these dates with double zeros mean so much. But the second coming of Christ is really very much related to being born again. It's when we have that coming of that Christ consciousness, that God consciousness that we embrace, that comes in and suddenly is abiding within us and we're aware of it. The Christ consciousness is calling each of us to be who we really need to be. And when you're at that new level of awareness, you have another spurt of growth in your spiritual awareness and spiritual consciousness. So that consciousness can lead you, like any divine idea. We just need to recognize that the divine idea exists and be willing to express it. Our minds are always connected with the divine mind. So this week's takeaways. Number one, let go of our worn-out assumptions and rules that we've made for ourselves. Number two, step out of the comfort zone that we've been living in. Number three, we are born again and again and again and again. Be willing to speak God's name, I am that I am. What do you truly identify with? Number five, act as if you are a spiritual being having a human experience. Number six, allow your Christ consciousness to express. And then number seven, what has more meaning to you? Jesus' life or Jesus' death? And like I said, I'll go ahead and post this on our Facebook page here a little bit later today. So when you live your life like that, and you come to the end of all you know, and all that's in front of you is darkness, you can't see what's right ahead of you, having the faith to step forward and know that one of two things is going to happen. Your foot is going to hit solid ground, or you will instantly know how to fly. From the Gospel of John, 14th chapter, 12th verse. Truly, truly, I tell you, the one who believes in the Christ consciousness will do all of the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. And may you always be open to God's guidance and grace. Let's prepare for meditation. Mm-hmm.